month of May is the month of family celebration, since we celebrate Mother's Day, graduation, and of course final school days before kids are set free for 2-3 months. So it is appropriate for us to take time and seek God's blessings for ourselves and those that we relate to. So far I have not met any person, I have not come across any person who would say no to seeking God's blessings or God blessing them. We never say no to that. Psalm 67 is the shortest psalm, and it was written for the liturgy of the church. In fact, the Church of England for many years used this psalm every Sunday to be read during the worship service, which meant that by the end of the year, you already had learned this psalm by heart. Why is it so? Because this is the psalm of Aaronic blessing. You remember Aaron, when he was appointed the priest, he was given a special chosen appointment by God to be the first priest, appointed priest, to tell you the truth. And this is how that Aaronic blessing unfolded. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. Yeah, I'm reading the King James Version. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. This was the blessing that each time two people met, each time the two people departed, friends, families, neighbors, communities, even moving from one land to the other, this blessing was uttered in the presence of the Lord so as to leave the blessing of God for the person coming in and going out. To tell you the truth, this is rooted in the covenant that God made with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verses 2 and 3. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee all families of the earth shall be blessed. This is the basis of this covenant, this basis of the blessing, and that blessing that echoes in Psalm 67. And not only that, when Christ began to teach and preach, he taught his disciples the Lord's Prayer. And it says, Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. How is that possible? Unless and until there is a relationship, unless and until there is a shared blessing with each other. Without that, relationships fall apart. And this psalm, if you pay attention, maybe you can go home and read this for your time of devotion today. It has only 7 verses. First 3 verses are identical to the last 3 verses. And verse 4 is the pivotal point on which everything depends. The psalm encourages us to seek the Lord. You know, as I am getting older, things are getting harder to find around the house. I know I'm looking for something. I walk from this room to the other where that thing is, and then I look all around the room. Do I ever find it? By the time I find it, I forget why was even I looking for. What was the purpose of finding that thing? The word seek means to look for something so diligently, so feverishly, that you know what that thing is, what the purpose of that thing is, where will you use it, what would be the outcome and the blessing that you receive from it. Seek the Lord. Remember, in the New Testament, there are three stories, in fact, two that we can relate to, where the seeking went on very diligently. This woman who had maybe a headband or a necklace of 10 coins, and she lost one, and she swept the whole house and looked in every corner and every nook and moved the furniture, and I envy her. All the hard work she put in to find that one coin that she lost. But when she found it, she celebrated with the neighbors. This man who had 100 sheep lost one. But he left the other 99 and went into the darkness and looked for this lost sheep. And when he found it, he brought it home and called in the neighbors at night time. While I'm sleeping, somebody waking me up and saying, come to my house, celebrate with me. I found a sheep, the lost sheep. But that was his joy, seeking so diligently till you find it. What did Christ say when he was being criticized to eat with the sinners? He said, the Son of God has come to seek those who are lost. And seek means to keep looking for, keep looking for, keep looking for, till you find what you came up for and make use of it. We are called to seek the kingdom of God. My school motto was, when I went to junior school in India, the school motto was, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. At that time, it didn't make any sense to me. Everything about God's kingdom and seeking and this and that. Why? Because I was running after all these other things that were promised to me to be added unto me. I wanted those first and then the kingdom of God later. But then with my experience and growth in faith, I found how important and how central it is for me to be seeking God's will for my life each and every day, and living through that faith every moment of my life. It hasn't been easy, believe me. But when you continue to seek God, the blessings of God add on to you. Why do we have to seek God? Why do we have to seek God's love? Why do we have to seek God's kingdom? Because God has placed us in this world as human beings who are in tune with His Spirit. First of all, that seeking has to be rooted in God's grace. And this is how I define GRACE. It is the basic concept of God's reconciliation at Christ's expense. Get it? GRACE. That's what grace is. God's reconciliation at Christ's expense. Since God has already reconciled with me, He has already sent His Son to die on the cross, to lay down His life, to be the ultimate Lamb of God that was slain, to be the sacrifice that was meant to bring forgiveness to humanity. That has already been accomplished, all because of God's reconciliation towards me. And since God has already reconciled, what is there for me to lose? He has already set the table, He has prepared the banquet, He has offered His Son, and along with that, there is the message of resurrection. It's not only that Christ died for me and you, but there is the message of resurrection that is laid on the table. And this morning, we are preparing ourselves to seek God's kingdom because of God's grace that speaks to us in these symbols of the broken body of Christ and the blood of Christ that was shed on the cross. This is the grace that allows us to be always present in God's kingdom while we are alive, even after we die. God's grace leads us. And friends, grace is something that we have not worked for. Because if you work for it, then grace becomes the wages, right? That becomes your earning. This is a free gift of God. And maybe that's why there is a threat among us when we hear about God's grace freely given. Remember that song, freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Maybe there is a threat that how is it possible that God loves me? I know I'm a sinner. How is it possible that God still loves me and God gives me His grace? But scriptures remind us that God's eternal love is shown in this grace aspect, that He allowed His own Son to die on our behalf. Coming from Psalm 67, the message of Christ's sacrifice and death and resurrection allows us to take a look back into the history that God was at work ever since Adam and Eve were driven out of the Garden of Eden. God was showing His grace, sharing His grace with humanity each and every step of the way. Why do I have to seek God's kingdom? Not only that this is God's grace, but it is also that God's own presence in me, with me, makes the whole difference how I live my life. When God let His face shine upon you, when God let His presence reveal to you, watch out. You remember when Moses was on Mount Sinai? He stayed there for 40 days and 40 nights in the presence of the Lord, receiving the commandments, talking to God, being in His presence. And when he came down from mountain, his face was so glorious and shining that people said, please cover your face with a veil. All kinds of beauty treatments that we take to keep ourselves bright and shiny and youthful, they lose all their luster when you have spent half an hour in the presence of the Lord, bending on your knees, praying to Him. And the brightness and the glory and the light and the peace that emanates from your face, people know that you have already sought God's presence. You have already looked for God's grace and mercy in your life. Many times we think that seeking God is an individual challenge. And that's why we are discouraged. Individually, oh, you know me, how sinful I am. And in my own nature, in my own skin, I know that it's not possible for me to even be able to go in the presence of the Lord. But when we are in this community, in the corporate nature, in the family nature, in the faith community nature, it is here that God speaks to us. He speaks to us not only as God for one person, but God of the whole world. There is no such thing as individual Christian. Many times we think that way, and many people don't come to church because they think that they are Christians already in their own standings and they can be good Christians without being in the church. But they are just like those coals that have been taken out of the fire individually and put one side. What happens to that coal? Slowly it gets covered with ash and the heat and the light diminishes. It disappears. But in the corporate nature of my faith, I am uplifted and supported. Someone asked an African American pastor, "How can your worship services last like for 3 or 4 hours? You people just continue to worship, keep on worshiping." And the pastor replied that the world out there tells my church members that they are nothing. They don't count. They are no good. They have no status. But within these four walls, as a family of faith, it takes me that long to assure them that God still loves them, that their lives matter. So whoever wrote Psalm 67 knew that within our humanity, you and I, we will feel separated. We will feel as if we have no value, that we don't count. But God is trying to say that when we begin to seek His face, when we begin to look for Him, He's already looking for us from the rooftop. Remember the father of the prodigal son? The son had left the home, gone into the world to have his own way, but the father never left the rooftop. He looked and he looked and he waited and he waited till the son came back. Psalm 67 is about that reunion. You and me, experimenting in the world, and God waiting for us on the rooftop. With all these symbols of salvation, forgiveness, reconciliation, love, and peace. This morning we have the Lord's table prepared for us. We are invited to come together to break the bread and to drink of the wine, symbols of Christ's broken body and His blood. This is not our doing, this is God's doing for us. And we accept this as free gift of God. And when we join, when we seek God, then we are found. And then the fruit of the Spirit begins to grow in us. Remember Galatians 5:22. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, happiness, all together rolled into one. God offers that. This morning, it is your opportunity to be blessed. So come as you are. It's an open communion. Let's open on page 12 in our book of hymnals as we follow the order of the table. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who are destined to repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess
that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your law. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Now the great thanksgiving on page 13. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Friends, God's blessings are waiting for us. We are called to seek. And in seeking, the part is that I need to come to the Lord's table. This is the starting point. And as I join my faith with faith of those who have gone ahead of me, who will follow me, there is a link of relationship that is established. And you and I receive that blessing in taking part in this banquet of God. And as we humble ourselves, present ourselves to the Lord, he embraces us like the father of the prodigal son, finding the long-lost child back home, rejoicing, celebration. That's what seeking is all about. So come as you are. It's an open communion. Everyone is invited to come. Ida, would you like to come and help me serve the community?